emergency response function, or force vibration of undamped system. Okay, so I think in this class we looked into the frequency response function, did we not?
We started looking at B.
We started looking at it. So in all fairness, let's do a better job. So as we looked, as we said, I call them observations, right? And this was observation 6. And as I said, if you look at the response of a structure under the action of a load, let's say static load, and this is the response or the displacement, and the stiffness of this beam is K, the static displacement would be F0 over K, right? And as we have learned now from the response of an undamped system under harmonic load, if instead of this static load, we have a load which is a cyclic load whose amplitude is the same as this static load, this is a dynamic displacement. Let's call that delta, okay? And this is 1 over r squared times that delta, okay? So one way of naming this then was that we call this amplification or magnification factor, because what this shows, it shows that how under a similar load to the static load, except that this is acting cyclically in basically cycles, the dynamic displacement is magnified by this factor. Magnified is a wrong word because necessarily it's not enlarged. That's what magnification means. But what this means is that the dynamic response changes according to this function. If you plot this function or the absolute value of this function, which we call that frequency response function, at least this is an introduction to the frequency response function, you see this, that if you plot that against R, at R equal to 0, this would be 1. As R increases and approaches to 1, right, what happens? This would basically goes to infinity. In other words, at R equal to 1, the response is unbound. This is what we call resonance, right? And we saw that what happened. Response is a harmonic response with a growing amplitude that goes unbound. And again, as R increases now, now we see that this is going to decrease. And the way it's going to decrease is that at another point, which is, in fact, R is equal to the square root of 2, right? Again, this becomes 1. So in other words, this increases. And then as R further increases, this goes eventually to 0 in the limit. So it happens that at the frequency ratio, this is a frequency ratio, right? Ratio of the forcing frequency over the natural frequency being the square root 2, or the forcing frequency is the square root 2 times the natural frequency. At this point, if the system behaves as if you have a static response, because it's the same response as the static response. And it's beyond that, that in fact the displacement increases. So it is interesting that, as you see, if the ratio of the frequency of the forcing function and the natural frequency is greater than the square root of 2, right? In other words, for r greater than the square root of 2, especially if this is very, very large, the system as if doesn't even move in terms of displacement. Okay? Imagine a jet engine supported on this wing, which is relatively a soft system compared with, you know, basically a structure. Stiffness is not that much. But the jet engine is operating at such a very, very high frequency, the wing doesn't even move. Because the frequency of the forcing function is so large compared with the natural frequency of the system, you don't feel any motion at all. That's, which is interesting. If you've ever been in an airport watching the plane basically turn the engine on and before, of course, taking off, you see absolutely no displacement movement in the wing. So it makes you wonder, with such a heavy engine rotating at such a high frequency, why is it that this wing is not even oscillating? That's the reason, okay? So that's basically introduction to this frequency response function, which we'll see that in more details and elaborate that in the case of damped systems. There's another case also that we encounter that necessarily is not like resonance, which is a sort of a critical situation, but it's, we encounter sometimes in practice that natural frequency and the forcing frequency are almost the same, very, very close. So let's look at basically understanding that case, which has some significance, and so it's good to look at it, okay? So if you remember, we write the total displacement of a harmonically excited case, both the transient and the steady state part, it was this, right? This is the total displacement, F0 omega over m times omega n squared minus omega squared times 1 over omega sine omega t minus 1 over omega n sine omega n t. If you had an undamped system, under the action of a sinusoidal load, and the system start from zero initial conditions, zero displacement, zero velocity, this is the total response. Now we are going to look at it, what happens if these two are very close, not exactly the same, but very close. So let's call the difference, I would set up some values here. I would call omega minus omega n a small value. So let's call that 2 delta omega. Instead of delta omega, I call it 2 delta omega, because you will see that in mathematically, this would make the expressions look easier. So if you do that, let's see what that means. Omega is n squared minus omega squared is what? Is omega n, can be written like this, right? Omega n plus omega. If these two are very close, obviously, according to this assumption, this would be 2 delta omega. Since these two are very close, I can say this is 2 omega n. So this would be a negative 4 delta omega omega n. So that's this part of the denominator of this fraction, right? Now, let's look at this expression. Now, slightly rearrange that. In other words, I will move this inside the bracket. So I have omega here and omega here, okay? So let's now look at what I have inside this bracket. Omega over omega cancels out, so that becomes sine omega t. These two are very close, so I can say this is one, so I have minus sine omega n t, okay? I will now rewrite that expression by using the trig identity. I don't expect you to remember that, but if you have sine alpha minus sine beta, you could write that as cosine alpha plus beta 2, cosine alpha plus beta 2 times the sine, okay. Times sine alpha minus beta over 2. Okay. That's from trig identity. Okay? So if I substitute that in there, you can rewrite this now as minus 2 sine of omega n minus omega n omega 2 t cosine omega n plus omega over 2 t, right? But this was 2 delta omega. So here we get negative 2 sine delta omega t. And this is, again, very close. They're very close. So I write that as 2 omega n divided by 2 becomes omega n t. So this is what we have in this bracket, right? So, and the numerator, I mean the denominator is this, right? So what that gives you then is ut is equal to f0 over m, right? Divided by, this is the numerator, so negative of that, 4 delta w omega n times negative 2, sine delta omega t cosine omega n t. So 2 and 4 cancel out, and you get basically what you end up with getting F0, sine omega, delta omega T divided by 2 M omega N delta omega, cosine omega n t. If you plot this function, you see that you get, if I put that you're recording this so I can erase this and create some room here right next to this expression that I can plot this. If you plot this function, it will be a harmonic function with a diminishing amplitude, like this. This is the amplitude that basically goes out of phase, in phase. So this is the amplitude, F0 sine delta omega t divided by 2 m omega n delta omega, okay? And the function, that part is simply like this. So you have a sinusoidal function, that is amplitude rises and dies out, rises and dies out, okay? This is called beating phenomenon. Okay. I'm sure you've come across that, you've encountered this in your life sometimes. Can you think of anything that resembles that? And you have two sources of vibration with very close frequency that you hear, especially in acoustics, that the noise goes up, dies out, increases, dies out. Can you think of any practical case, anything? In the other class, somebody who was a musician actually mentioned something which was interesting. You have two instruments playing, you know. That's how the job of the conductor is so important, to make sure everybody's in tune, right? You have two instruments that are slightly out of tune with respect to each other. If they play in the background, if you're sitting not very close, a little bit far, you see that. This kind of an amplitude in your ear, it goes up, dies out. Another example is you're sitting in a two-propeller engine airplane, especially if you're sitting on the wing. You see the sound that builds up, dies out constantly. That's the beating phenomenon. You have two sources harmonically oscillating, but with frequencies that are very, very close. Those two engines, of course, their frequencies of operation should be identical, but there is no such a thing in reality, so very, very close. So that's called the beating phenomenon. With that said, we are done with undamped forced vibration, except that it's good to do an example, right? So let's do that and bring this to a closure and move on to the more next and more interesting topic. So in studying forced or harmonic vibration of undamped systems, okay, I would say harmonically excited. That's what we did, undamped systems. We learned a few new things that were very important, okay? The first phenomenon was resonance, right? Then frequency response function that we were exposed to. And also, okay, understanding the meaning of the amplification of dynamic response versus static response. Because this is very important in design. When you're designing a system, you learn how important it is to know exactly what is the ratio of the frequency of the potential forcing function as it compares with the natural frequency of the system. We also learned, of course, obviously, how to derive the equation of motion, okay? And what was the shape of the equation of motion. So this is what we learned, okay? So let's just do a quick example, because there is not more to that. So I'm going to just do one example problem to at least show you the application. So let's say you have an undamped system subjected to a forcing function that looks like this, 10 cosine 10 t, or that's the forcing function, The stiffness is 40 pound per inch. Weight of this mass is 38.6 pound. And F of T is given. The system starts with initial conditions of zero. Okay? Although, you know that mathematically, it is wrong to write this, right? You know why, right? Can I write 10 minus 10 is equal to 4 minus 4? No, I cannot. Why not? Because if I do that, I can write 2.5 times 4 minus 4 is equal to 4.4 minus 4, right? This cancels out, so 2.5 is equal to 1, right? So you cannot do that, okay? So you have to write it like this, okay? So anyway, so that's the problem. So the problem is asking you to do these two things. Derive the equation of motion, and then plot the response. Basically, we want to understand the behavior of this. Of course, we've seen enough how to set up the model, this is represent the model of the physical system. We've spent enough time that to be able to set up that model for any physical system. So let's say we've already set it up and this is what we have. We have a system given. We want to make sure that the forcing function acting on the system, you know, doesn't destroy it. So for what we want to do is we want to find probably the maximum dynamic stress that this system would be subjected to if you have this for the beam, for instance. Okay? So let's go one by one. So the total response looks like this, right? This is what we know. F0 over k, 1 minus r squared, cosine of 10 t, right? Plus the transient part, A1 sine omega n t plus A2 cosine omega n t. So this is the transient part, this is the steady state part, right? So we want to substitute these initial conditions so that we can find those unknowns. But before we do that, let's substitute for the values we have so we know numerically at least those values. F0 is given as 10, k is equal to 40, so F0 over k would be 0.25 inches, okay? Omega is 10 radius per second, omega n is k over m, weight is given, so you need to divide this by 32.2 times 12, and that comes out to be 20 radius per second. So omega over omega n, or r, is 10 over 20 is 0.5. So we have everything we know, we need to know here, right? So let's substitute for that, for those, I have here, this is 0.25, okay? This is 1 minus 0.5 squared, okay? If you divide those two, that whole thing is 0.33. So now, to find A1 and A2, let's substitute for this. If you do that, this would be 0, right? This would be 0, So you just have a, this would be cosine 10 t would be 1, I'm sorry. So this would be 0.33. This would be A2, so you have A2 plus 0.33 is equal to 0. So A2 is negative 10.33. If you substitute for U dot, 0 is equal to 0, you take the derivative and put it, you know, and so on, you end up with basically A1 comes out to be 0. So the total solution then would look like this. U of t would be 0.33 cosine of 10t minus 0.33, okay, cosine 20t. That's what the total solution would be. In other words, this is the sum of two sinusoidal functions, two cosine functions. Okay? If you plot these separately and add them up, or whichever way you do that, plug it in your calculator, this is how the response is going to look like. Okay? Just I would do my best to do a good job of drawing it on the board. So let's see, I have that in here somewhere. Okay. So let me find a plot of that in here. It's gonna look like this. Okay. If you plot this, this is what you get. So, and this is almost 0.6, roughly, which is the maximum displacement, okay? Of course, before you started, you could predict that what that maximum displacement, the range of that would be, because what you have here, okay, for 1 over 1 minus, first of all, your R value, okay, is 0.5. So if you think of the frequency response function, right, this is 1, this is 0, so R is somewhere here. So you know that dynamic response is less, I mean, is greater than the static response for this range, obviously. You're within this range, so dynamic response would be larger. And that's what you ended up with, because the static response is what, 0.25 F0 over K, and this is about 0.6. Okay. Any questions? So, with that said, let's see where we are and where we are going. So sure, you have no questions? So don't you ever write 0 is equal to 0. Okay. In fact, you know, I remember that when we were kids, I'm not sure it was in elementary school, somebody actually posed that as a trick that I can prove that any number is equal to any number, right? You can write 3 minus 3 is 0, 8 minus 8 is 0, right? And factor things out, and you can prove that 3 is equal to 8, whatever number you want. Okay? Okay. Okay, so this is where we are. We talk about forced vibration, right? For the particular case of harmonic loads. We've looked at now force vibration of undamped systems. Okay, so that's done. Now we are going to look at what happens if you have a damped system. Okay? So, physically speaking, now the system that you have now consists of this. Right? You have a forcing function, which is this, and we want to solve the differential equation that this system represents, or the equation of motion, describes the equation of motion, which is this. Okay? So that's what, similar to the undamped case, we want to solve this differential equation. And of course, as you remember, we, by defining the critical damping and damping ratio, we rewrote this equation in a form that is more meaningful because it does show directly those important physical, I mean dynamic characteristics of the system, damping ratio and the natural frequency, right? So divide the two sides by m, you can write this equation like this. How do you solve this differential equation? There are several ways. One, by using Laplace transform, which I can understand that all of you like it so much that, you know, and probably some of you have not been exposed to it. Another way is assume the particular solution is of a general form, the complex exponential form, substitute that in there and find the amplitude and the phase angle. But again, that may be a little bit such that you don't like the mathematics. So we will consider the traditional approach. If you have a damped system, very much like the undamped system, the complete solution would consist of two parts, that the homogeneous and particular, or the transient and the steady state, right? And we know that, as we saw in the undamped case, the particular solution was a function that was in phase with this forcing function. So we assume that is A sine omega t. In this case, in the introduction of damping basically violates that assumption. So the particular solution in general would be of a form like this, plus or minus, doesn't matter. So now we have to find two unknowns, both the amplitude and the phase angle of the response. And of course, the homogeneous part, we know it already, right? The homogeneous part for a damped system, for the case of versus underdamped, you remember, was something like this, versus if the system was underdamped, right? So in other words, the homogeneous part we know. So let's focus on the particular solution, and we just add it up later, like we did in the case of undamped system. So all I'm going to do is just substitute this. Since if this is the assumed solution, I just substitute in this equation, and then whatever the terms of sine omega t is on this side, equate that to this, and if you have like cosine omega t or anything else, there's no other terms here, so that would be equal to zero by rearranging it. So let's do that. So let's substitute that into that equation. So you have, first of all, u dot would be what? U dot would be a omega cosine omega t minus theta. U double dot would be a negative a omega squared sine omega t minus theta. So substitute them here. So you have negative A omega squared sine omega t minus theta, right? That's u dot, plus 2 zeta omega, okay, n, right, times this, okay, actually as u, yeah, right, okay, so you have 2 zeta omega n times omega a cosine omega t minus theta, right? And you probably didn't notice that I had dropped a term u here, right? So plus omega n squared times that, which is a omega cosine omega t minus theta, is equal to f0 over m sine omega t. If you rearrange that, okay, this is what you will get. So I will just rearrange that, and that's what this is what you will get by rearranging it. You get A omega n squared minus omega squared, okay, sine omega t minus theta plus 2 zeta omega n omega cosine omega t minus theta is equal to f0 m sine omega t. Okay? We don't have sine omega t or anything, cosine omega t on this side, but if you look at these terms, right, you do remember, or may not remember, from trigonometry, there is an identity here. You can write this cosine omega t, cosine theta, minus sine omega t, sine theta, and this one is sine omega t, cosine theta, minus cosine cosine omega t sine theta. So what you need to do, you just factor out all those sine omega t and cosine omega t terms on this side, right? And if you do that, this is what you will end up with. You get, okay, I will write it here. You get A times omega n squared minus omega squared cosine theta plus 2 zeta omega n omega sine theta sine omega t plus A times omega n squared minus omega squared sine theta plus minus 2 zeta omega n omega cosine theta is equal to f0 over m sine omega t minus sine omega t, okay, which is what we have. That's the forcing function. So now you see that on the right-hand side, you have a sine omega t term and a cosine omega t, okay, term. So the coefficient of sine omega t, which is this, which I will rewrite that, A times omega n squared minus omega squared times cosine theta plus 2 zeta omega n omega sine theta. This should be equal to the coefficient of the sine omega t on this side, that is f0 over m. And this, this is a coefficient of cosine omega t. There is no cosine omega t on the other side. Has to be zero. So you have a times omega n squared minus omega squared sine theta minus 2 zeta omega n omega cosine omega t is equal to zero. So you have two equations and two unknowns. The unknowns are a and theta that you want to find, right? In order to do that, what I will do, okay, I would multiply this by cosine theta, this by sine theta. If I, and then add them up. If you do that, this and this would cancel out. So on the other side, you have F0M cosine T, right? On this side, you get cosine squared times this plus sine squared times this, or you get basically A times this, okay, is equal to F0M cosine theta, okay? Then you just have to basically divide these two and do a little bit of mathematics here. If you do all of that, what you get, you see that it results in the value of these two unknowns to be this. You will get A to be F0 over K divided by 1 minus R squared squared plus 2 zeta R squared, okay, square root of that, and then theta will be the arc tangent of 2 zeta R over 1 minus R squared. So this is the equivalent of what we did last time. In the case of undamped, this was either 0 or 180 degrees, which basically didn't matter then, because the response and the forcing function were either completely in phase or out of phase. So this was basically didn't matter. This is now what? This is, as you can see again, what is this term times the equivalent static displacement. Or in other words, this is the magnification factor, or the absolute value, which is the frequency response function. As we will see now, in this case, this term is no longer the function of one variable, which was the case in undamped system, only function of the ratio of the frequencies, but is also a function of zeta. So we will see the, in fact, importance of the frequency response function now in studying damped systems, and what this frequency response function is, what information, including, for instance, evaluation of damping, that can result from studying this, and also a lot of other pieces of useful information that we will extract from the concept of frequency response function in this case. See you on